Thank you for attending the IDEX Solutions Lunchtime Webinar. This is a series of webinars that we're putting together for people to see how CATIA and Smart Team, or the Dassault family of products. I'm Susan Crowden, and I'm the PLM Account Executive here at IDEX Solutions. So I want to go over a couple of housekeeping issues while we're here. I'd like everyone to please mute your phone. So you need to press *6 to mute it, and unmute, you press #6. Otherwise, we can hear everything that's going on in the background. The webinar series is it started out as an 8-part series. I think it's been extended a little bit. But if you attend 4 or more of these sessions, you'll be entered to win an iPod Touch. So if you're teamed up somewhere and you're attending a meeting on somebody else's login, please send us an email and let us know that you're attending the meeting so we can count you towards the iPod Touch. The presentation is going to be 45 minutes long, followed by 15 minutes of Q&A. So at the end of 45 minutes, if you have no questions, please feel free to drop off. If you have questions and you want to stick around, please feel free to stick around. Next slide. So a little bit of information about IDEX Solutions and who we are and what we do. We were founded in 1996, and we have offices in Portland, Seattle, and Los Angeles. We're a Dassault value-added reseller, as well as an IBM business partner, and we sell and distribute service and support CATIA, Innovia, 3DVIA, and Delmia for implementation services, customization, automation, training, that sort of thing. As well, we're an engineering services provider. We do on-site engineering as well as process consulting for many different customers throughout the United States. So with that, I'm going to introduce Greg Albrechtsen from Dassault Systems, who is the FEA specialist for the CATIA product offering. Greg?
Okay, thanks. Hi, everybody. As you mentioned, my name is Greg Albrechtsen, and I do work for Dassault Systems, and I primarily focus in the Simulia brand of products, and I'll kind of explain that. There's a little bit of confusion out there in industry. Who is Simulia? What is CATIA? What's the difference? And I'll explain that as I go through here in a couple slides. But you know, my background is I've done a lot of FEA for many years in aerospace industry, also consumer industry as well. So you know, I've been around the block. I've done everything from medical implants to aircraft components. So I kind of understand the trials and tribulations that everybody goes through for analysis. As Susan mentioned, this is part one of a 2-part series announcing some of our new products that we've released in R19. And the part one today is going to be our description of our nonlinear analysis capabilities inside of CATIA. And the part two is going to be a thermal analysis. So I encourage you to, again, follow up and come listen to the part two, because I'll show you how the two workbenches can also work together with the thermal analysis as well. So with that, here's a brief agenda of the items that I'm going to go through today. I'll give a brief background of who Simulia is. I'll do a brief background on CATIA analysis capabilities, and then I'll dive straight into the nonlinear products, and then just kind of wrap a few things up and try to point out some different things for your specific industries that perhaps you're primarily focused in. So the power of 3D, you know, we have, you know, within that, so we recognize about 11 different industries, and we have, you know, specialized solutions to attack each one of those industries. But, you know, for you, what that means is our products are completely scalable. It, you know, we can solve everything, as I mentioned earlier, to something as small as a medical implant to a full vehicle, whether you're talking about a car or an airplane, or something electronic like a laptop. You know, we have solutions, whether it's design solutions or analysis solutions, for each one of these particular industries. So with inside of the portfolio, you know, we have, this is our different brands that we represent, you know, everything from Delmia for, you know, virtual production, to Innovia for data management, CATIA for design, and Simulia for analysis. And what Simulia is, 2 years ago, Dassault Systems purchased Abacus Corporation as their, you know, first-in-class nonlinear capabilities, which they have, and now all of the analysis capabilities are kind of being branded under Simulia. So Simulia doesn't necessarily just mean Abacus. What Simulia is it's all the analysis products that run in the Dassault Systèmes portfolio. So that includes all the integrated CATIA analysis products. And the focus today is to specifically talk about those integrated analysis products that run right inside of your current environment of CATIA. So with inside of our portfolio for Simulia, we have four different product regions or categories, if you will. I mentioned the CATIA analysis products. That's one of our product tricks. The other is Abacus. That's for a lot of really high-end type analyses. Maybe you're looking at delamination of fiber composites or crash or something like that. We also have EyeSight and Multiphysics within inside of our portfolio. What that does is that helps you do, a various multitude of optimizations with EyeSight, optimize your processes, and Multiphysics lets you incorporate maybe some of your in-house code or your CFD code on simultaneous simulation at the same time. And Simulia SLM, what that represents is that's a data management specifically designed for simulation data. So it takes all that data and processes that you've generated through creating your analysis files, whether it's loads, boundary conditions, meshes, results, and it not only stores that data, but it also helps you manage that process and store that process electronically. So that's kind of Simulia. Our main goal and our main focus with inside of Simulia is to, truly present and virtually simulate your real-world working conditions. So we want you to be able to model everything up, the correct materials, the correct atmosphere, the correct loading. We want you to be able to take everything virtually and model that as near as you can to the real world so you can, reduce your design iterations and increase your performance, and the reliability that you're going to have when you go ahead and, manufacture this product and give it out there to your customers. We want you to be able to predict and give them, the cheapest product, the best product the first time through. So that's our main goal. So to do that, again, I kind of mentioned the different products that we have. And if I look at this chart, we have three different areas that I look at here and three different products that focus on those different areas. So if I look at the horizontal bar here, that would be the level of expertise that, the user experience would have. So we position these products everywhere from somebody that's a designer, maybe they have a degree, maybe they don't have a degree, up through the PhD specialist who, they're sitting in the corner and they're just doing the really high fidelity type analyses. So we organize these products so that everybody along that spectrum can actually utilize these and enhance their designs and, make their designs smarter. And the vertical bar here, what that represents is the technology sophistication. So if I think at the very bottom of this bar, that might be a single part, a metal single part, a very low level sophistication for FEA. I just want to analyze, an aluminum bracket. That would be at the very bottom. Now, the very high end, at the very top of the scale, what I'd be talking about is, maybe highly nonlinear contact, large deformation, hyperelastic material, just think of whatever depth of sophistication you can, come across in your design, that's the level for that. So our different products, there's a little bit of overlap, but primarily they're focused like this. So if I want to, analyze a metal bracket, maybe I'd be looking down here in the linear CATIA analysis product. If I need to analyze a crash of a vehicle, then that's going to be a really high level of sophistication and also require a high level of expertise. So that's going to fall up here in the Abacus products. Now, we have taken some of our Abacus products and we've incorporated those inside of the CATIA environment as well. So that will allow you to use the power of Abacus right inside of the CATIA environment. But what I want to talk about today is basically this block here, which we now have incorporated some of our Abacus technology inside of the CATIA analysis environment for basic nonlinear and thermal simulations as well. And I'm going to focus just on the nonlinear today and thermal in the part two. Well, as the portfolio sits, maybe you're aware of all the products, perhaps not, but I'm just going to give a brief overview of what each product does. From the ground level, GPS, that's, you know, linear stress analysis. You can mesh parts, you can put loads and boundary conditions on a part and do, you know, linear static solves with that. GIS helps you enable that and enhance that to then, you know, be able to do that with assemblies, do bolts, you know, bolt connections, contact fittings, you know, pressure fittings, whatever you have there, we can do that as well. FMS and FMD, what that does is that enhances the GPS meshing capability to let you go in there and really define exactly how you want that mesh to be. I want a node, you know, across this particular edge at this distribution. You know, I need to project one mesh onto a different surface. You know, we have a lot of great advanced capabilities here. Hex meshing, if you're interested in that as well, we can do that here. GDY gives you basically dynamic response analysis. So if you want to do a quick dynamic forced response, we can do that here. Look at some different reactions in the mode vibrations. And then EST is going to give you advanced pre and post processing. It lets you solve and set up multiple cases at the same time. It gives you advanced report techniques and different things like that as well. So again, new this year with the release of R19 SP3, we have released two new products. One is ATH, which is the thermal analysis package, and then ANL, which I'm going to talk about here for the nonlinear structural analysis. So just to give a recap on what are the basic capabilities inside of CATIA V5, hopefully you guys are all here because you're using V5 analysis already, but there's a few things that people don't realize for different advanced capabilities in here. You know, it is based on the same API structure. It's built right inside of CATIA, so it's the same interface. So you don't have to do, you know, data import, export, you know, you don't have to mess around with IGES files and recreating your meshes every time you go through a design iteration because it is the same environment. So you can, you know, take that full associativity and, you know, you can build in knowledge where and you can modify parameters and you can just really build in a lot of intelligence in these models to, you know, to enhance your design and optimize your design as well. You know, from the designer standpoint, it's a great product. It's super easy to use. You know, it lets you go through and properly size a design. You know, do I need a half-inch plate, a 3/8-inch plate? You know, how many different, you know, support welds or, you know, different things like that you need, bolt counts, all that. So even though you might not be the one to stamp your design and say, hey, this is stress-free, this is a great product to use to provide, you know, a better product through to the high-end analyst to the first time through so that they don't have to go through so many design iterations and they can really focus on the high-end analyses. So it's a great tool for that as well. So speaking of the high-end analyses, you know, again, it's a very powerful tool. So those people that are the CAE specialists can use it as well because we do take into account hybrid assemblies. So if you want to mix and match solid shell, beam elements, you know, you can do hybrid assemblies. It allows several designers to work together. You know, we have the context of assembly of analyses. So, you know, multiple people could be creating meshes on multiple sub-assemblies and then bringing that together in a top-level assembly so that you don't have to create everything from the very top level. It helps, you know, disseminate the workload across the group a lot better. We have realistic connections, whether it's a bolted connection, a welded connection, spot weld, seam weld, surface weld. We have all sorts of different enhanced connections there as well. Other things that you can do with the product is, again, because it is an integrated product inside the CATIA interface, it's fully compatible with the KnowledgeWare products. So PEO is a great place to start for optimization. You can use PEO to optimize on your mass. If you need to reduce your mass, if you're overweight, you can use that to help, you know, change your design for that. Maybe you need a particular stress or displacement value, you can use PEO to help, you know, drive that simulation as well. On top of that, because it does work with KnowledgeWare, you can set up very smart templates. So this here is like a little Bluetooth adapter, and what we have is the basic foundation of this design is the same for this bottom enclosure. What is changing through this design is the little button. using templates, what you can do is set this first one up with templates using published connections and things like that, you know, using the published feature with inside of Assembly. What that allows you to then do is have all your connections connected to your publications, and then it's very easy to swap in and out just by a simple right mouse click replace component. You can swap in different parts here, and it recognizes all those connections already exist, all the mesh parameters already exist, and then you can really just set it off to the solver again. So it's a really quick way to set things up for design templates as well. So that's kind of a brief overview of the CATIA analysis products. The next thing we're going to talk about is the new product, which you're all here for today, which is the nonlinear analysis product integrated inside of the CATIA environment. So just a background, you know, CATIA V5, the analysis, you know, the standard GPS product is linear. This is really great for small displacements, small rotations, small deformations. What does that mean? Well, you can go back to your handbooks or different things like that and figure out, you know, what does a small displacement mean? Is it, you know, 2% of strain or 0.2% of strain? You know, you can go back and look at those things. The other thing that it assumes is it assumes a linear force displacement curve. It assumes there's no yielding. So, you know, if you're looking at a material curve, you know, you're looking just in the pre-yielding stage. And that's great for having confidence in your designs, but a lot of times this leads to over-design and not optimized products. You know, you typically, you know, when in doubt, build things stout, right? So using some of the nonlinear approaches, you can really, really finesse your design and get a really optimized design there. And the material properties are independent from time and temperature. So that's the linear assumptions that we have inside of V5. And that works for a lot of cases, but sometimes we need to extend that. If we look at everyday things that we encounter, you know, pressing your finger against a balloon, you know, maybe that seems like a simple analysis, but that's pretty highly nonlinear because you have a really thin membrane and it's really going through a large strain deformation. So something like that we typically can't do in the, you know, the GPS product, so that's why we have the A&L product where we can do this large deformation, large strain type analyses. Flexing a pay-per-click back and forth, okay? May seem like a linear analysis, but it's not because it's going through a large deformation. It's going through a very large plastic strain. You're permanently straining this product. So our nonlinear products will, you know, calculate what that permanent plastic strain happens to be. So you can look at the effects of post-yielding or things like that. Just simple loading of a plastic part. You know, maybe your loading's fine. Maybe you're not going through any large deformations, but you know, your material characteristics are nonlinear. The new A&L products will allow you to import and bring in whatever your material curves happen to be, and then your stress strain can follow those curves as it goes through the solve time. So, you know, if you're looking at any sort of plastic parts, you know, you really probably do need to look at using a nonlinear approach. And an example of that could, again, be this clip here. You know, this clip I solved both with a linear approach and a nonlinear approach. And if I take just a, you know, with the same loading, the same force loading, if I take a look at the stresses of the linear, the stresses are reported higher at, you know, 12.7 KSI, as with the nonlinear, you know, because this actually did extend into the nonlinear region of the material curve, the true stresses of this were actually only 9.8 KSI. So in this simple example, this product for the stresses is over-designed, which, you know, may give you a higher factor of safety, but again, if you're looking at material savings and design optimization, it's over-designed. You know, you can cut a lot of material out of there. But on the flip side of that, if we look at the deflection for this, on the linear assumption, our deflection is only 0.14 inches, and on the nonlinear approach, it's 0.19 inches. So again, you know, depending on what your design criteria happens to be, you know, this is not really an accurate simulation to do this, you know, this simple clip with a linear approach. So you could either be over-designing your product or under-designing your product, depending on, you know, if stress or displacement is important to you. So within the products, the capabilities that we have here is, you know, we can simulate any material characteristic that you have, any nonlinear effects. We can import those and put those in there. You can do the thermal studies with the thermal ATH product, which we'll talk about next time. You can do advanced contacts, so we can do gap opening, gap closure for the advanced contacts. You can define friction, you know, ratios within them as well. The other benefit that we have with the new ANL product is it internally utilizes the Abaqus technology. So what that's using is, you know, it's using first-in-class nonlinear solution technology, because Abaqus is, you know, the best in industry for nonlinear, and it's a standard across industries as well for nonlinear analyses. So you get that capability and that, you know, satisfaction and security that it's using the Abaqus technology behind the scenes. And this is also available for parts or assembly. So it doesn't matter if you're doing a nonlinear analysis for a part or an assembly. All these work for whatever you're looking at there. So, you know, again, it provides a more advanced structural analysis by including nonlinear capabilities, where we're talking about just a nonlinear static analysis, where that's a large displacement, large rotations. We can take that in effect now. The nonlinear materials, whether you're looking at plastic materials or metal plasticity, we can also incorporate rubber hyperelasticity in this as well. So if you have a very highly nonlinear curve that follows some tertiary pattern, you know, we can simulate that as well. One of the other great benefits, which I'll be showing in a quick demo, is a multi-step analysis. So you can go through the loading of your part, how it actually gets loaded in the real world, and set up those different steps. Perhaps you go into plastic strain, and then you can remove the load, and you can look at, you know, what your permanent strain is in your part as well. Natural frequencies, and this can also include preloading effects from that. And I mentioned advanced contact previously. So a lot of great capabilities in here. So what is the importance of considering large displacements? So just simply thinking about large displacements, you know, if this bottle, if I put a top load on this, you know, this thin bottle, and I solve that both in a nonlinear and linear approach, this is kind of the chart that I would see on the load versus the von Mises stress. So you can see, again, the linear is, in this particular case, is underestimating what the true stress is going on with inside of the part, and, you know, the linear error in this particular example is about 33%. So it's just a simple bottle, but again, depending on what your load is, if, you know, for this up around 200 newtons or what have you, you know, that's quite a bit of error. So you could get some product failure where maybe you thought you were actually over-designing again. You know, what about this case here? We have maybe a hyperelastic button. You know, we're looking at the displacement versus the pressure. Again, you know, because of the taking in effects the large displacement functionality in the nonlinear solver, for this example, we're getting about 67% error. So really, depending on what your situation, what you're trying to analyze is, 67% error is way off. So you're not even close with a linear approach for this very simple product. So, you know, just a background, I don't know what the level of knowledge and expertise is for the people on the call, what is nonlinear, what is linear, but this is a simple stress strain curve that we have, and the linear approach pretty much just follows the example from point one to point two. So, you know, as long as you're loading within sort of that strain and that stress realm, then you're fine. You know, you use a simple linear package. That'll work. That'll be fine. But typically that's not where we are today, because we're trying to really get the most performance out of all of our products. And we're going to extend to point three or point four, and we need to really see what's going to happen. Well, if inside the ANL package, you can load this all the way up to point four or past, and then you can remove that load, which will then, you know, bring you back down to some sort of permanent strain, and then, you know, as you unload that and remove all that, you're going to have some sort of permanent strain in there as well. And, you know, we can predict what that happens to be. Maybe you're looking at spring back, or, you know, just some sort of strain loading past yield. Again, here's an example of the hyperelastic material. So if you have a very complex, you know, curve here for the engineering stress strain. You know, we can bring that in and it can follow that as well. So you can see this product's not only going through a very large deformation, but it's following a very highly nonlinear curve here as well. And this is all really easy to do in the software. You know, the software pretty much takes care of itself once you import the material curve. So multi-step analyses, I mentioned this briefly before, but basically what this, again, allows you to do is think about this truss. As I assemble and as I put this truss together, you know, it's going to go through a series of steps in the real world. The first thing that's going to happen is, you know, all the beams are going to be, you know, placed in location. And then they're going to put the bolts in there, and they're going to tighten these bolts up to some sort of, you know, pretension that, you know, they have defined. Once that pretension has been set, then, you know, there's going to be some service loadings on the structure. Well, after those service loadings, maybe you want to look at, you know, where do we have failure, where do we have, you know, yielding. You can apply that service loading to whatever your, you know, requirements dictate. And then using the multi-step process, you can then go ahead and, with inside the software, remove those service loadings, and then you can look at any sort of permanent strain or permanent deformation that happens to be in the part while that bolt pretension is still on. So you can do a lot of really advanced different techniques with inside the software for, you know, using a multi-step approach. Multi-step analysis can also be used for, you know, frequency modes. So, you know, maybe I have a particular stress at a particular, you know, some sort of RPM. I'm spinning this around. I want to take a look at the frequency analysis of that. You know, I can incorporate that into the design, and then I can go ahead and remove that and take a look at, you know, what my residual stresses happen to be there. So you can look at the natural frequency preloading effects as well. The other thing that we have is intermittent contact. So we have some advanced contact techniques in here as well. What that allows for is during solve time, it allows for the contact to open and close throughout the solve time. A lot of linear solvers just take a quasi-static approach to that and always have contact. But here within the nonlinear products, you know, you have intermittent contact and you can go through that and it'll, you know, iterate each whether you have closure or not. So with inside of that, for your advanced contact, you can incorporate frictional sliding. So what this means to you and me is you can put in, you know, any kind of frictional coefficients or penalty factors or user-defined, you know, friction parameters, however you want to define what your friction is going to be, whether you're looking at static friction, kinetic friction, you know, as your part gets loaded and goes through the motions of real life scenarios, you know, you can take that in effect as well. Okay, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch over to CATIA, and I'm just going to show you a quick example of what we have for automatic contact detection as well. So this particular example has this skin stringer, and what I want to show you is a couple different techniques how to go in and create all the connections for this. And I'm going to use a combination of what's currently available in the GPS product and what's also now available inside of the new nonlinear package as well. So hopefully everybody can see my CATIA session here well. I'll close a couple of these windows that might be blocking something. So what I have is a skin here with a bunch of stringers, and I've set up a series of points along here as well. And what I ultimately would like to do is connect all these stringers and ribs to the skin. So for each one of these points, I'm going to have a spot weld connection. Well, that's a really easy functionality that already exists within inside of the CATIA analysis environment. Basically, what I want to do is pick the two components that are going to have an interaction, and then I just need to simply select that geometrical set that contains all those points. So now I've set up a relationship between those two components, and now I can come in and say, okay, what do I want that actual relationship to be? And so I can come into that connection that I just quickly created, And now I can define that those are a spot weld connection, and I have a lot of variability in here how to define what that is going to be. So, you know, whether I want those element connections to be rigid, spring rigid, beam, hexahedrons, however I want that to create those connections between there, I have that sort of control. So that was really easy, really simple for a spot weld connection. So that's great if you have all those points already. But what happens, how do I connect the rest of this assembly? Well, we have an automatic search utility now that allows me to detect new interactions. So if I already have interactions in here, I can manage those in this as well. I can do both at the same time. But what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to detect new interactions. And I can have this search on my entire model, or I can select particular components that I want to search on. So let's say I want to search on this component here. And then what I'll also do is I'll just go ahead and pick that base skin as well. So now what I'm doing is just searching all the connections within sort of a, you know, some sort of search tolerance criteria. And it's going to go through and it's going to scan my part and it's going to find those interactions. When it finds those interactions, I'm going to go ahead and have it automatically create a connection for me. And I can specify what that connection type is going to be. Is that going to be a fastened connection, or is it going to be a contact connection? If it's a contact connection, then I can go in and further define friction coefficients and whatever I want to do there. But here for this example, I'm just going to go ahead and do a fastened connection. I'm going to go ahead and run this. So this is running real time. It's going to go ahead, and it went out there and found 30 connections already. So now what I can do is, you know, I can just scroll around here. I can highlight one of these connections. And now I can find out that there's one of the connections back there. It tells me which is a slave surface, which is a master surface, and then I can go ahead and finish and accept all of those. And now you can see the analysis connection was automatically populated, renamed, so it's got smart naming in there as well, and you know, I've got all that connection criteria, create all the properties for me. And all that information as well. So it's a really great, great utility for, you know, automatic contact detection. So, you know, what other capabilities do we have inside the nonlinear package of A&L? You know, if you want to look at thermal stress analysis, again, you know, you can import a thermal temperature loading, you can bring that inside the nonlinear package, and then you can, you know, do an analysis of that from any temperature-dependent material. You can incorporate that and look at your thermal stresses and things generated from that. The advanced contact I mentioned, you can go through and do the automatic contact detection, as I just showed you there, and then you can go through and do fastened contacts, friction, press fits, and all that in the advanced contact fields. So, the other thing that I would like to show you today is I want to show you an example of, you know, why is step loading important? You know, where does it benefit you? How does it help you? So what I have here is switch to my other session here. So what I've done is I've gone ahead and prepared a model and solved it because I don't want to, you know, have you wait for any sort of solve time on my laptop. But I basically have this pipe with a fitting. For this first example, the only thing that I have done, the only loading that I have done here is I've done some pre-tension and some pre-bolt loads on this top fitting. So with a linear package, you know, they do a, you know, superposition. So if I went ahead and did bolt tightening and pressure, it would be the same as me solving both of those individually and then adding them together. Different things, you know, you may want to look at in this particular example is for this, what I have done is I went ahead and just did the bolt pre-tensioning on this cap, and I generated some sort of von Mises stress, you know, in the resulting material that's about 780, so not very high. But if I go ahead and take a look at what happened with that inside of the nonlinear package, what I can do as I went through this, I did a bolt preloading and then I did a service loading as I solved this. And what I'm looking at now is the first step was the bolt preload. So something just as simple as a bolt preload, you know, depending on what the values are and what your thicknesses of your materials are. Again, you may want to look at using a nonlinear solver for that, just because of the advanced contact that you have between all these components. So even here, this is slightly off for this particular example. The next step would have been to go ahead and do that pressure loading. So this example here is, you know, using a linear approach. So this contains the pretension in the bolts and also an internal pressure loading of the components here as well. You know, and I was very careful to load these, you know, accordingly so that I could get these particular effects. But now if I take a look at, you know, what my max von Mises stress happens to be with using a linear approach here, I get about 2,500. But then if I go ahead and look at that using this in a step process where first it's clamped down with the bolt pre-tighten, and then I go ahead and apply the pressure loads. If I go ahead and look at the von Mises stress for this one, you know, I get about 8,000. So again, because, you know, I loaded this pretty high and I kind of knew where the material was, but I just want to kind of get the point out that both of these examples have the same pressure loading and the same bolt pretension, but I get drastically different results. So there's different scenarios where you really want to take a look at using a nonlinear approach, where a linear approach may not accurately do what you want to do. So how do you set something up like that? Well, it's really pretty easy. I'll switch back over to this one here. So now let's say I want to go ahead and let's do a nonlinear analysis of this component. So how do I do that? Well, just like anything inside the CATIA analysis workbench, what I can do here is go ahead and just switch over to the nonlinear workbench. I'm now in the nonlinear analysis workbench. A few of my icons have changed. A few of them are repeated, so I don't have to swap back and forth. But the first thing I want to do is insert a structural case. Now let's go. This creates a nonlinear structure case, just like it would in you know, GPS with a static case. I have a few different things in here in the structure case that wouldn't show in the static case, which makes perfect sense. But the other point is, if you notice that the nodes and the properties and the elements, all that is outside of these two. So it's still using the same measure, the same technology. It's still using the same geometry. It's just, you know, it's the nonlinear workbench now. So, you know, how could I go about creating these bolt preloads and things like this? Well, it's very easy. So the first thing that I want to look at is the simulation history. And here's my static step. So the first static step that perhaps I want to do is, you know, maybe I want to add in a bolt preload or something like this. So I can take a look at the bolt tightening connection property. I can highlight that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to be really smart here. The way I set this up is I set it up in the assembly workbench with constraints. So I'm going to go ahead and reuse some of those constraints. So I can go ahead and pick that. There's my bolt preload. I go ahead and pick this bolt nut. You know, so I could just walk around my part and pick each one of those components. And then as I look, you know, those connections are now created inside of this particular step loading here as well. So then the next thing for me to do to add on additional step or step loads is I can simply just go ahead and insert a new static step. So now I have step one. Now I'm in step two. I can define what those solving parameters are. And now within step two, what I'm able to do is go ahead and now I want to add the pressures. So then I could walk around my model and I could select those surfaces that I'd like to add the pressures to. And now we notice in the loads, I have a pressure in static step two, but in static step one, I don't have any pressures here. So you can kind of see as that goes through and I create this, I can go through and I can do that step process. Well, now, what if I want to do another step? I can add a third step in here. And now it's very easy to come in and maybe turn off this pressure. So now I can deactivate that pressure. So what this does is this goes through your step process. It takes this information, transfers that into the next step, and then you can, you know, remain or keep those boundary conditions on if you want to. You can add new ones. that affects from here on, and then you, in the next step, you can take whatever those results were from the previous run, and you can, you know, again, go through that procedure and that process of how your parts are really, really loaded in the real world. You can step through that. So it's really easy to do, and then, you know, just we send that off to the solver when I'm ready to solve it, and it's that easy. Okay, so that kind of gives you a brief overview of what the capabilities are with the nonlinear package and capabilities there. It's, you know, it's nothing tricky. It's pretty easy, just a new workbench with new icons. You know, I just do want to mention the Abacus for CATIA workbench. You know, again, if you really need to get to a high level of detail, if you want to look at fracture, failure, advanced concrete models, you know, gasket elements and things like that, you know, we can still do those kind of capabilities all integrated inside the CATIA analysis environment. With inside of our portfolio, a lot of things that people aren't aware of is, you know, we do have a CAA partnership program. What that does is these people, you know, join our program, and through joining the program, we give them access to a special set of APIs, and then they can go ahead and build their code directly on top of our AVIs or APIs right inside of our CATIA environment, and they can build a tightly integrated CFD package, for instance, that operates directly on our geometry, on our direct APIs. There's no data import, export. It's all right there on the same structure, same data structure. So it's a great portfolio. So if you're looking through our portfolio of products and you don't see a particular capability offered or whatever, you know, give us a call, and there's probably a partnership that we have for that particular capability, because we let people focus on what their main core competencies are. So before I open this up to questions and answers, I just kind of want to go through a few quick industry use case slides, you know, perhaps hopefully pinpoint a couple of your different industries of the people that's represented on the call here, and show you, you know, maybe some of the functionalities that have benefited other companies inside of your particular industry. So aerospace, obviously you have a lot of large deflection things going on, whether you're looking at composite parts or just metal large deflection. Automatic contact detection, very handy in aerospace, because, you know, you have a lot of parts. You have really big assemblies, and it's a pain to go in there and create these connections one at a time. So going through the automatic contact is great. Obviously, the step loading, as I showed, nonlinear material, sensors, and optimization. So again, with these very large structures, it's, you know, a good idea to take advantage of the optimization characteristics that we have to optimize those designs. Automotive, very similar. You know, nonlinear material. You know, here we see a lot more hyperelastic, you know, little buttons and grommets and gaskets and things like that, that take an effect that maybe aren't in other industries. Large deflections, pre-stress states, you know, they're looking at maybe a press bit or pre-stressing a component, so when it gets loaded, you know, it has a different sort of loading characteristic. A lot of bolted connections, you know, we have automatic bolted connections, as I showed you there, so a lot of great capability to pinpoint for your industry. Consumer goods, the biggest benefit that I can see in consumer goods is nonlinear material. You know, consumer goods people are using a lot of plastics and different things, you know, large deflections, large loading, large strain rates, and different things like that. So now we have a really great integrated solution to help you design your products better here. High tech, you know, I bring up ATH here again, but, you know, ATH is great in high tech. You know, maybe you have a motherboard or a circuit board that has some sort of temperature loading, and you want to take a look at, you know, how is that temperature going to affect the, you know, the deformation of the rest of my components and different things like that. So, you know, we can take that in effect as well as a lot of really small feature self-contact. So that's a great capability for high tech. Energy, you know, energy industry is huge. So it kind of touches on every capability that we offer in these products. You know, thermal loading, thermal temperature dependent, transient analysis, steady state analyses. A lot of frequency analyses looked at here, a lot of advanced materials. So again, energy is huge and can take, you know, really great benefits of the new products. So with that, hopefully we've been able to give you a good overview of, you know, what are the capabilities inside the nonlinear analysis package. And, you know, I'll turn it back over to the folks there at IDEX, to Susan, and open it up for any questions we may have.
Thanks, Greg. That was a great presentation. I just wanted to run over a couple of things. If you'd flip up my last slide.
Sounds great. I appreciate it. All right. I can do that.
I just wanted to, again, say thank you and remind everyone, and people came on during the course of the presentation, that we are having a webinar series over the course of the summer. So, again, if you sign up for four or more, you'll be entered to win an iPod Touch. So for anybody that came on the call late and is watching this presentation on somebody else's login and we don't have record of you, please drop us an email and let us know. I wanted to remind you also that next week we're going to be doing Designing Complex Molds on July 9th. I think that's a product that is very, very interesting. And at that, I'm going to – oh, I wanted to also mention that the products that Greg showed you, the nonlinear structural analysis, requires a seed of GPS, which is the generative part structure analysis too. So GPS is a $10,000 item or module that sits on any base configuration. And then the nonlinear sits on top of that config for an additional $12,000. So I wanted to be sure to let you know. Greg, did you mention that you were going to be doing thermal analysis at a later date?
I think I mentioned that a couple times.
Yeah. So the thermal analysis product is available as well. It's a $6,000 item on top of the GPS configuration also. So I just wanted to make sure everybody knew that, you know, that product is available and it's ready now to be distributed. And with that, I will open the floor to questions for Greg. Anybody have questions? It's so awesome, everybody wants it. Do you guys know that to unmute your phone, it's #6? Are there no questions for Greg? Okay, with that then, we will thank you once again for attending the seminar and hope to see you next week on the call. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.